thank you for being courageous enough to come back in and listen to me. I will talk about evolving epidemiology in pneumococcal disease in Europe. And as we heard this morning, Staphylococcus pneumoniae is the most important bacterial pathogen in community-acquired pneumonia. And we heard also that the European Union is not that unified or uniform. And I think you will find those topics again in my talk. So when we talk about pneumococcal disease as such, it's also a broad entity with non-invasive disease, such as otitis media, sinusitis, and non-bacteremic pneumonia. And those entities in adults and elderly, we mainly recognize there the pneumonia as an important infectious disease. On the other hand, you have the invasive diseases caused by the pneumococcus, and you have there bacteremia as such, or bacteremic pneumonia, and meningitis. And those entities we encounter in children, but in older people also, with even a more higher impact on mortality in that older population. So it's quite a different disease with several disease entities. And also, people affected by pneumococcal disease are in different risk categories. You have the older people, healthy older adults, who are at risk of contracting pneumococcal disease. You have a population that is really at high risk, and that is the immunocompromised population, and the population with some conditions like cerebrospinal fluid leaks. And then you have the population with chronic illnesses predisposing them to pneumococcal disease, such as chronic heart, lung, liver, and kidney disease. So it's also a quite different, differentiated population you see affected by pneumococcal disease. This was a situation before pneumococcal vaccination in children was introduced. And you see that incidence of pneumococcal disease was quite high in children, that there was also mortality in children. And then at the other age end, for older people, you have also that high incidence. But the main difference was that a high mortality was present in those older people. We have vaccines, and we have four or five vaccines at this moment. We know the polysaccharide vaccine, and that has been around already quite a long time, introduced in, I think, the 80s. And mainly its indication was vaccination of adult risk groups, younger risk groups also, and older persons. And then by the year 2000, 2003, the conjugate vaccines came in, first the 7-valent, then also 10-valent, 13-valent vaccines, the conjugate vaccines. Those conjugate vaccines had first their indication for vaccinating children, because they work in children and young children. The polysaccharide vaccine doesn't mount a very good response in those young children. And by conjugation, the pneumococcal vaccine does. And so from there on, also the development of higher valent vaccines. And more recently, 2010-11, also the indication for adult vaccination was put in place with the 13-valent conjugate vaccine. So we have the scene there with our different vaccines available in those different populations. Here they are. And I think it's quite unique that in one vaccine, there are a lot of antigens present. So when you vaccinate with a pneumococcal vaccine, you vaccinate with several antigens, capsular antigens in there, and you hope that an immune response is mounted against all those serotypes included. And by broadening the scope of a vaccine, we hope that more circulating pneumococci with those serotypes will be eliminated in the epidemiology. And of course, the rationale is the more, the better. And in that way, the 23-valent polysaccharide vaccine should have a high potential there. There are some policies on pneumococcal vaccination that are somewhat puzzling and also provoke different viewpoints and controversy. This is the WHO position paper on pneumococcal vaccination. And they state, and I think it's true, that pneumococcal conjugate vaccination in childhood is very important and should be introduced in the immunization program for children in all countries. They also say that for the adult population, the use of the conjugate vaccines needs further data, and that the highest priority should be introducing the conjugate vaccines in children, and that evidence does not support routine immunization of elderly and high-risk population with the polysaccharide vaccine. So this authority makes us wonder what to do with our older population and the population at risk. At the other hand, very wise people in several organizations, professional organizations, issued also guidelines for vaccination of older people, and it's European, so there we find a recommendation to vaccinate older adults with a pneumococcal vaccine. And when you read through it, you will see that the recommendation is both for the conjugate and the polysaccharide vaccine. So different viewpoints there, and also that raises some problems in implementation and interpretation. The controversy goes further. We heard about Gaetan and his criticism on Cochrane. I will do the same. Well, they did a review, and you see that they conclude that there is evidence that invasive pneumococcal disease is prevented by the pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine. But that the evidence is not that clear in chronic illnesses and for the older population, and that there is no effect on all-cause pneumonia or mortality. That's a conclusion of a meta-analysis of the Cochrane. On the other hand, they very recently did a meta-analysis on a chronic illness and the effect of the polysaccharide vaccine. And it's somewhat strange to see that they find an effect there. So it contradicts their previous meta-analysis for this specific chronic disease. It prevents COPD exacerbations by 74% and CAP by 48%. No effect on mortality or hospital admission. So they come to a very different conclusion there. Controversies. I believe in meta-analysis and in recent meta-analysis. Why? Recent data are there. Methodology should be better, certainly when it is published in a high-quality journal. So from the nearly 20 meta-analyses, this last one, plus one, 2017, is probably most trustworthy. An effect, RCTs in pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine show an effect on invasive pneumococcal disease, 73%, and pneumococcal pneumonia, 64%. So RCTs demonstrate, in this meta-analysis, a great effect. What about observational studies? Observational studies, we have more of them. So also there, invasive pneumococcal disease and vaccine-type invasive pneumococcal disease, an effect in cohort and case control studies that is substantial. And the same for pneumococcal pneumonia. Thus, observational studies show an effect of our polysaccharide vaccine in elderly persons. So one should say that the most recent meta-analysis does point out that there is an effect of the polysaccharide vaccine in our older population. Ingo already told us about the CAPITA trial, and he pointed out the, some important things. First of all, it was a randomized controlled trial with a lot of persons in it, but when you see at the age distribution of this study, our older population was rather underrepresented, 85 years and more only being about 3.5% of the population. So the question is, will this answer our questions about the effect of a conjugate vaccine in our older population or the population at risk? The study showed an effect on invasive pneumococcal disease, vaccine type pneumococcal pneumonia, that was impressive, and that's why this study had a large impact on vaccine recommendations in adults and older persons, and a lot of recommendations include now the conjugate vaccine. Ingo showed that this effect is not uniform in all age groups, and that mainly in the oldest old, the effect is waning away. We don't know if this is a true failure of the vaccine in that population, or whether this population was just underrepresented. But no hard evidence for an effect from the age on of 75 and certainly over 85. This is demonstrated by this study, that until the age of 77, there is maybe, there is that effect coming from the CAPITA trial, but over that age, it becomes more and more, or less effective, and not so clear that there is that effect. So we stay with the problem of, is there an effect in our oldest population coming from that conjugate vaccine? So recommendations are there in several countries, and coverage of vaccination is very heterogeneous in Europe. You have countries where no recommendations are there, or there is no recommendation to vaccinate with the pneumococcal vaccine, like in the Netherlands. The Netherlands, they don't vaccinate with a pneumococcal vaccine in the adult population. Then you have countries such as mine, Belgium, where the uptake of pneumococcal vaccination in the older population is very low, only around 10%. On the other hand, you have more successful countries like the UK, where, as you see, 80% of people 75 or older have been vaccinated with the pneumococcal vaccine. So there is a large heterogeneity in vaccine coverage for pneumococcal diseases in Europe. Well, how are vaccination recommendations implemented throughout Europe? And this is an analysis of the situation in Europe we are performing at this moment. And you see that it differentiates a lot from country to country. 13% will recommend vaccination by the conjugate vaccine, 42% by the polysaccharide vaccine, 15% both, and then there are some countries with varying options and no recommendations to vaccinate in 8% of European countries. What about the strategy to revaccinate? Well, you see that a booster is recommended in 16% of European countries, no booster is recommended in 44%, and that you could consider, it is open, boostering in 20% of European countries. No booster recommended also in 20%. So this underlines also this variation in recommendations for pneumococcal vaccination in adults throughout Europe. What about herd protection? This black sheep is not vaccinated, but is it protected by the vaccinated white sheep for pneumococcal disease? We're talking about pneumococcal disease. Well, these are data from the United States. It should be a talk about Europe, I know, but why look at the United States? They have the longest history of vaccination against pneumococcal disease, both in adults and in children, and they have a good registration and surveillance in place. So, data that are trustworthy. But just show you a few things. These are rates, incidences of pneumococcal disease in children, and you see between 1998 and 2015 a very large drop in incidence of pneumococcal disease in children in the United States. You see the same drop of incidence in older adults, 65 and over. And you see that it follows the same trends as for young children. So the impact of pneumococcal vaccination, conjugate vaccination in children is there also in older people by this herd protection effect. What about mortality? It's the second important thing to look at. Do we prevent deaths from invasive pneumococcal disease or not? In the United States, you see a very large drop in mortality in children, but also in the oldest population. As I showed in the beginning of the presentation, the highest mortality is there in older persons, so also there, by herd protection, you see that the mortality of invasive pneumococcal disease dropped and is half of that that it was in 98. So those effects are quite large. They say that more deaths are prevented by vaccinating children than by vaccinating the target population itself. Another still European country at this moment is the UK, and a nice registration of data from England and Wales. They have a weekly follow-up of their incidence of invasive pneumococcal disease. And here you see for England and Wales the evolution of the serotypes included in the 13-valent conjugate vaccine, or in the conjugate vaccines. And the drop you see here, sorry, I must point here, I was pointing there. You see the first drop was the introduction of the 7-valent conjugate vaccine, and by enlarging the coverage of the vaccine to the 13-valent conjugate vaccine, even more invasive pneumococcal disease by those vaccine serotypes was prevented in children. The same you see in the older population. The drop of the 7-valent vaccine and here of the 13-valent vaccine. So also there, proof of that herd protection effect. What about the serotypes that were included in the 13-valent but not in the 7-valent vaccine? Well, that was the reason to enlarge the coverage of the 7-valent pneumococcal vaccine. You saw replacement disease, more other serotypes, but again, with the 13-valent vaccine, a drop of those additional serotypes in the 13-valent conjugate vaccine. The same is true, again, in the oldest population. Rise with the 7-valent conjugate vaccine, although serotypes additionally in the 13-valent conjugate vaccines, and a drop when that 13-valent conjugate vaccine was introduced. Okay, what with serotypes that are not included in the vaccines? When you take out the most prevalent serotypes in your epidemiology, does something come in the place of those serotypes? Well, there are replacement serotypes that come in. And you see it happening with the 7-valent, but also with the 13-valent conjugate vaccine in children. And also, as you expected already, in the older population. So it has a drawback. You can eliminate the most prevalent serotypes, but other serotypes come in, take their place, and are causing also invasive pneumococcal disease. The overall picture is, of course, important, and there is a lot of gain in reducing overall burden of infections from pneumococci. Some Belgium data on it. Well, overall, we have also a drop in the prevalence of invasive pneumococcal disease, and you see that the drop is there in children, the solid line, and in other age groups as well. When you eliminate serotypes in the vaccines or reduce them in incidence, also the coverage of your vaccine will tend to be lower. You could wonder in the end, supposing that all those serotypes were eliminated, you would have an ineffective vaccine. You see that there is a drop in the coverage of vaccines, of the 13-valent vaccine and of the 23-valent polysaccharide vaccine. But this drop is pronounced, but you still see the potential of the higher valent polysaccharide vaccine that is there. So that's why there is, in my opinion, still an important role for our polysaccharide vaccine. And this is just to show that indeed those serotypes in the vaccines are eliminated and tend to be lower, and that some of the other serotypes, for example, here in the polysaccharide vaccine, are becoming higher, 12, 15. So you have some replacement in invasive pneumococcal disease, other serotypes that are causing the disease, serotypes that are not in the classical conjugate vaccine, but still in the polysaccharide vaccine, so therefore its importance. Let's look at what I could find from our unified European Union. We have the ECDC, and the ECDC is registering invasive pneumococcal disease throughout Europe. And you can produce nice maps like these to look at IPD rates. Here for children from these countries, and this is the trend in overall invasive pneumococcal disease in children. So a drop, and here at the end, a little bit of a rise. This is Italy as an example. What about IPD rate in older persons? The same, Europe here, and that's incidence rates. And it's not that clear for Europe what's happening now. A little bit of a drop and then again a rise. So not very clear. You see that some countries don't manage to report, Belgium, Germany, really hard incidence rates. That is a problem, something to be considered in recommendations how to go about in the future concerning surveillance. What about the case fatality? Are less people dying or less children dying from invasive pneumococcal disease in Europe? And here you see that we don't see a lot of change for overall pneumococcal disease in Europe, but the data come only from a minority of countries. So also there, improvement in registration should be there. The causes, serotypes, all serotypes that are reported are non-PCV13 serotypes. The same for the older population. The drop in mortality is not evident, except in Italy. Very good. You see that the registration of case fatality in Europe is very scarce. The serotypes, yellow stars, non-PCV13 serotypes, red stars, PCV13 serotypes. This one is serotype 3, and we didn't see any effect on serotype 3 with our conjugate vaccine. So that's somewhat troubling, because this serotype 3, as you see, is a major killer in the older population, and we don't have an effective vaccine against serotype 3 at this moment. The other red star is 19A. 19A is in the 13 conjugate vaccine, the 13-valent conjugate vaccine, and you see that it still stays an important cause of invasive pneumococcal disease. What happened in Belgium is that for the vaccination of children, we went back from the 13-valent conjugate vaccine, including 19A, to the 10-valent conjugate vaccine, because the tenure from the other company was cheaper. The government decided to go back to the 10-valent vaccine, knowing that 19A was a replacement serotype in Belgium under the 7-valent conjugate vaccine, that it was maybe lessened as a cause of IPD in the 13-valent conjugate vaccine. The 10-valent vaccine will be the vaccine that doesn't cover it at this moment, so we will have to monitor whether it reappears or not. So it's rather complex. So this demonstrates the conjugate serotypes in the 13-valent vaccine and the evolution, and there you can say, okay, we have an effect on incidence of invasive pneumococcal disease caused by vaccine serotypes, and also for the older population, it's like that. For children also, non-vaccine serotypes, there is a trend in Europe, a little trend in augmentation of invasive pneumococcal disease caused by non-conjugate vaccine serotypes. The effect on the serotypes in the older population, not that clear at this moment in Europe. The incidence and for non-vaccine serotypes, you have also a trend of this augmentation of invasive pneumococcal disease by serotypes non-included in the vaccine, the conjugate vaccine. So this brings me already to the end of the talk and some messages I would like to stress. First of all, controversies in evidence and in policies will make that implementation of a uniform strategy for pneumococcal vaccination in Europe is a demanding task and puzzling. And that evidence is scarce in our older population and in high-risk patients is something that is worth thinking about, because this is the population at highest risk. Then we have seen that the impact of vaccinating children is quite high. And the point was already raised, how do you differentiate a direct effect of vaccination of older persons from an indirect effect of vaccinating children? And then surveillance. Surveillance is very important to know how epidemiology in pneumococcal disease is evolving. And it also should be more uniform. A uniform registration of rates of case fatality should be in place in every European country in a uniform way. So for pneumococcal disease, a lifelong vaccination strategy is also of importance. Children, high-risk groups, and older persons, and also that a uniform EU policy is warranted to tackle this problem and to know what is happening with our vaccines. So this is the end, and in dark times for the UK and Manchester, there is always a little light. Manchester United won the Europa League soccer a few days after a disaster. And that's something as a message to think about, that human resilience is, I think, a very good aspect. Thank you. I thank you for your attention.